Scene one.
Good morning. Wasn't that lovely? Thank you, Leanne. It is good to have everyone with us this morning, and we'd like to especially welcome any visitors we have with us. It is good to have you here. I have a few announcements. Hope you will join us for our annual Christmas fellowship dinner today following this worship service in the Family Life Center. And also, there's a couple of trees throughout the church that we were asking for your help. You can help end world hunger by giving to the Heifer Project International Tree. And that tree is located in the children's education wing. And you can select a card and an envelope from the tree in that hallway and give it to the person that you are honoring, and then place your donation in the envelope provided in the offering box near the tree. And that will go to help Heifer Project. And then another tree is the Outreach Mission Tree. And that's an opportunity for you to remember or honor loved ones. And those proceeds will go to the Pack Shack and also the van. And the cost is $5, and you can get an ornament in honor of someone or an honor in memory of someone. And then finally, we hope you'll come and join us for the All-You-Can-Eat Pancake Feast this Saturday from 8 until 11. It's sponsored by the Disciples Men Fellowship. And then on Sunday, December 29th, there will be one worship service here in the sanctuary at 11. And we're also going to have a continental breakfast that morning at 9:30. So we'll hope you come and join us for all that. And there is a lot more in your bulletin. So if you would, look at those as you are able. But now let's continue with worship. Oh, Jan Dietrich? No, no, no. No Chris next time. Just all you. It's all you.
Before we sing our first hymn this morning, I do want to mention Susan Hampton had a Christian Action Time in the first service where she mentioned our drummer, Danny Gauss, who's played drums in here for us a couple times. He is shipping off to boot camp on Tuesday. And so she mentioned him, and she picked up a military issue Holy Bible and had his name engraved on it and presented that to him in the first service. And the first time we thought he was shipping out, which was a couple months ago, there was some generous donations made from members of the church and the praise team and the choir. And he is certainly grateful for that and for everything that the church has done for him. And we're certainly going to miss having him around at least for a little while until we can drag him back up here so he can play again. So be thinking about Danny and his family as he ships off to boot camp. Our hymn of praise this morning is number 76. We're going to sing verses 1, 2, and 4 of O Come, O Come, Emmanuel. If you will, please stand as we sing our hymn of praise this morning.
Ascribe to the Lord, O heavenly beings, ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Worship the Lord in splendor of holiness. Let's pray together. Lord God, from the candle and the cradle to the cross, we remember the life, the love, and mission of your only Son. For all he is and all he's done in our lives, we thank you and we join now to worship his holy name. Amen.
Others. Advent calls us to remember that
love is patient.
In a world where often we become consumed by our own interests, Advent calls us to remember that
love is kind.
In a world where often we are quick to anger and slow to forgive, Advent calls us to remember that
love is not easily angered, and through love we come to forgive.
This Advent, let us behold the love of God embodied in our Savior's birth.
God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God, and God in him.
This morning we light three candles. The first candle reminds us of the marvelous hope revealed through the Savior's birth. In a time of despair, God shattered the darkness with hope and of a new future. Us of peace that only Christ can instill in the heart, human heart, in a world that abounds with hostility. Christ alone is the one who speaks, "Peace, be still." The third candle helps us remember that God's perfect love made flesh can fill our hearts, ignite our souls, and change our lives.
Let's pray. Gracious God, as we continue our Advent journey, we pray that being rooted and established in love, we may have the power to grasp how wide, how long, how high and how deep is the love of Christ. True love was not only born at Christmas, but revealed for all to see. May we come to know this love in our lives and share it with those around us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Our hymn of devotion this morning is number 105. We will sing all three verses of Child in a Manger.
54th Psalm says, "With a freewill offering I will sacrifice to you. I will give thanks to your name, O Lord, for it is good." May we worship the Lord now through the giving of our tithes and offerings. Let us pray. Holy God, help us to bring our offerings with an eager heart, not as a comparison with others, but as an act of worship to you. May we find the comfort we desire and the strength we need. In Jesus' name, amen.
As I get the privilege to sit here, be in worship with you, and observe in worship with you, there are two things that make me happy inside to watch. One is when kids or children ever do anything. Do they get it right? It just doesn't matter. It just makes me smile inside. The next is when anyone is ever lighting a candle of any kind in this place. Whether it's here at the communion table, most of the time with the child, or here at the Advent candles, I will tell you that all of your looks are all the same. Wondering if it's going to get done correctly. Wondering if the lighter will last too long or get it done right. The observations are wonderful to watch from you all and to watch from the choir all at the same time. Observations are wonderful from here. There is another observation in our text that I want to share with you today as we come to the communion table. It's from the 34th Psalm, and it says this: "I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise will continually be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the humble hear and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt his name together." An observation. As you come to the table, how will you magnify and how will you exalt as you share and as we do this in remembrance of him?
Our hymn of preparation is number 374. We'll sing verses 1 and 2 of Your Supper, Lord, Before Us Spread.
We thank You today for the blessing of salvation that was brought to us through Jesus the Christ. We are grateful for the grace which Christ has given us, as well as the Holy Spirit living within each of us. We praise You, God, for calling us Yours and being our God. Thank You for this time of worship and the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. In Christ's name, amen.
He's just gathered with his friends. We're just gathered with our friends. In the middle of supper, in the middle of that time that they were together in the upper room, Jesus just takes the common and makes it uncommon. Jesus took bread and he said, "This bread is my body given for you. Take, eat, and remember me." After the meal, he took the cup. He took the uncommon and turned it into holy. He took that cup and he said, "This cup is my blood spilled for the remission of sin. This is the cup of the new covenant. Do this also and remember me." And so it is that we eat of the bread and we drink of the cup until he comes again.
It is at this time we're going to go to the Lord in prayer and thanksgiving. As I was preparing the pastoral prayer today, which I lost between first service and second, I think God did that on purpose. We wouldn't be able to go to God in prayer if it were not for his grace and mercy and for the absolute sacrifice of his son, Jesus Christ. What a gift. There are many listed in our bulletin, and if you would not mind, please open that up if you have not and put it on your lap. And then please pull into your heart and mind all of those that you know are not just ill and sick, but because of this time of year, they're lonely and excluded and apart. You know, the world is changing daily, and if you've watched any news in the last week, you'll know that we have so much to take to God in prayer. And let us put that burden down for a minute, those worldly burdens, and let's go to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, merciful God, thank you. Lord, you have blessed us as your children in ways and numbers we can't count. And forgive us, Lord, that when we're like those healed by Christ who got so excited with their new wholeness and health that they ran from him and they didn't even stop to give praise and thanks. Lord, forgive us because we do that every day. We know every blessing is from you, yet we're busy. We're thanking you now, Lord, for each and every blessing that you have given us. Father God, you taught us through your Son, Jesus Christ, to love this world, everyone in it without exception. Yet we pick and choose as it suits. Forgive us for that, Lord. Heavenly Father, as you give us blessings galore, we get sidetracked by the changes that are happening around us when our traditions change and how we celebrate changes, rather by children growing up and leaving our homes or by changes in the world around us. Lord, we lit an Advent candle for your love, Lord, and let us be that lantern this week, that light shines brightly, that the new traditions are born of that love, traditions that come from new family and new friends. Heavenly Father, thank you for the blessing of the people in this church. Lay that blessing on all of them, even those that are not with us today, but are with us in heart and mind. Father God, a special blessing of healing on all of those in our laps and in our hearts, Lord. We know by the power of our faith that there is a healing that you will give. And as you do your glory and your work, tell us how we can give them comfort from this place. Heavenly Father, thank you for our united hearts and mind, united in the light of your Son and in the absolute perfection of your love. And let us go to you together in prayer as we pray, as your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever.
I just don't know how glad I am to see all of you all today. It's wonderful. Glad you're here today. Because I know that there have to just be some scholars among us here today.
deep thinking philosophers that are here with us today. People who've thought about deep questions for a long, long time. Because I've got a good one for us today. So we're going to see how many scholars that we have amongst us today. Because here is the question. How long ago was it before the world began? That question kind of sets the stage for us today. How long was it before the world began? Now, my oldest daughter, Amber, when she was about 4, she came up with a great saying, and we've never forgot it. She said, "Dad, yes, Amber, I can remember things before I was ever born." I think she still believes it. The Bible tells us that long before the world began, God had a life-giving plan to bring redemption through Christ to all those who would choose to believe and follow. 1 Peter 1:19 through 20, it says this, "But with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect, he was chosen before the creation of the world, before the world began." God knew we would need a Savior. And God knew that we would need to be set free, and by sending his one and only Son, we could receive forgiveness and find new life through Jesus. Stage set. Throughout the scriptures, weaved through verse after verse in the Old Testament, are prophecies that speak of Christ, the Messiah, the Savior, the one who would come and do this thing. They told us. They told them, and they told us, they tell us still today. And Bible scholars have concluded that hundreds of years before Jesus was ever born, more than 300 prophecies were recorded to tell of his coming, his birth, his journey to the cross, and pointed to the power of the resurrection. And we're going to talk about all 300 of them today. Are you excited? No, we're not. But all of these prophecies point to the exact location, the exact circumstances, the exact timing of Christ's birth. And to me, it's just crazy. But only God, the only entity, the only one who could do this specific plan, ensure that they all come to pass, it just could only happen if God said it was just going to be that way. And he did. For Christians, for Christ followers, Jesus is the fulfillment of prophetic scripture. He is the one to which everything and everyone was pointing. For he is the Word, and he is the light, and he is the way, the truth, and the life. And John 1:4 says, "And in him all was life, and that life was the light of all mankind." They told you. They told us. And here it is. And this morning, believe it or not. So this morning, I'd like to do something really kind of fun. I didn't do this in the first service, but yet I'm going to try it with you, because believe it or not, you all are actually more interactive than the first service. Amen. Yeah. So when I say this little tag phrase of believe it or not, I'm going to do the believe it and you're going to do the just that way. So let's try it. Believe it
or not.
Love it. Okay. The complete message of Christmas, I'd like to share this. I believe it's wrapped up in God's greatest gift, who came as a tiny baby with a powerful purpose. And that powerful purpose was to save a lost world and to redeem humanity. So with all of these prophecies that are given, we're going to cover 10, and I promise I can do it in less than 18 minutes. So here's the first one. And these are in no order, but I want to share prophecy with us as we are in the middle of Advent. Here's the first one. Christ would be identified, known, filled with the power, peace, and the Spirit from birth. Prophecy, Isaiah 9, 6. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And the 61st chapter of Isaiah says, the Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me, because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim the news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim freedom for the captives, and to release from darkness prisoners. The fulfillment. It is Christ himself who does that. And we read it in Luke 4:18. See if this sounds familiar. The Spirit of the Lord is on me, because he has anointed me to proclaim the good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free. Church, he's not talking about people who were just blind. He's talking about humanity. Christ has come that we might not be blind anymore, that we might see the Redeemer. They told you. Believe it? Yeah, number two. Christ would be born a virgin. Now this is when we know a little bit better. Isaiah 7:14. Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. I just love this. You know, Leslie McDaniels, they have a sign company that they do, and they bring the signs to your house. You lease the signs, and for a birthday or anniversary or whatever it is that you want. And I read this, therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. And I thought to myself, what if we had a sign in every one of our front yards that said, the virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel. Would anyone knock on your door and ask you, what are you talking about? Wouldn't it be fun? That was the prophecy. Matthew 1:23. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. They told you so. It happened. Believe it
or not.
Yeah. Christ would be born in Bethlehem. Prophecy. Micah 5:2. However you thought, Micah, oh, that's a great book of prophecy. The Lord says, Bethlehem. You might not be an important town or a nation of Judah, but out of you will come a ruler over Israel for me. His family line goes back to the early years of your nation. It goes all the way back to days of long ago. Just flip to Matthew 2:10. Read the fulfillment. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem. They told you. They told you. And you can believe it. Number four. A star would point the way to Christ. It's amazing to me how God does things. Light pointing to the light of the world. Numbers 24:17. Has anyone here ever just flipped to Numbers to look up prophecy? And there we are. Yeah. Numbers 24:17. I see him, but not now. I behold him, but not near. A star shall come forth from Jacob, and a scepter shall rise from Israel, and shall crush through the forehead of Moab, and tear down all the sons of Sheth. The fulfillment. Matthew 2, verses 1 and 2. Now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, Magi from the east arrived in Jerusalem, saying, where is he who has been born king of the Jews? For we saw his star in the east,
and have come to worship Him. They told you so. And it happened. Believe it. This is a whole lot more fun than the first service, isn't it, Billy? Number five. This one isn't as exciting. And matter of fact, it's kind of sorrowful. But even in prophecy, we find sorrowful moments. There would be a great sorrow surrounding the time of His birth, and many children would be killed. And in Jeremiah 31:15, we read, "A voice is heard in Ramah, mourning, a great weeping. Rachel weeping for her children and refusing to be comforted because her children are no more. Herod's cruel scheme to kill Jesus, it didn't work. He ordered baby boys living near Bethlehem, 2 years old and younger, to be put to death. In Matthew 2:16, we read the fulfillment. When Herod realized that he'd been outwitted by the Magi, he was furious. And he gave orders to kill all the boys in Bethlehem and its vicinity who were 2 years old and under, in accordance with the time he had learned from the Magi. Then what was said through the prophet Jeremiah was fulfilled." Believe it. The sixth prophecy, the timing of Christ's birth and life would come before the destruction of Jerusalem and the temple. It's just right there in good old Daniel. Daniel 9:25-26, the prophecy reads, "Now listen and understand. Seven sets of seven plus 62 sets of seven will pass from the time the command is given to rebuild Jerusalem until a ruler, the anointed one, comes. Jerusalem will be rebuilt with streets and strong defenses despite the perilous times. After this period of 62 sets of seven, the anointed one will be killed, appearing to have accomplished nothing, and a ruler will arise whose armies will destroy the city and the temple," the fulfillment. Since Herod is known to have died in 4 BC, it's presumed that Jesus was born before then, sometime between 6 and 4 AD, and that his death may have occurred somewhere in between 29 and 33 AD. But before his death on the cross, Jesus had also told of the coming destruction of Jerusalem, hence confirming the prophecy of Daniel. There are three passages that tie this together for us. The first is Matthew 2:1. It says, "Now after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, wise men came from the east to Jerusalem." And in 1 Peter 2:24, "He himself bore our sins in his body on the cross so that we might die to sins and live for righteousness. For by his wounds you have been healed." And in Matthew 24, "Do you see all these things?" he replied. "Truly I tell you, not one stone here will be left on another. Everyone will be toppled." They told them. They tell us. Believe it. Number seven. There would be a presentation of gifts to him. The prophecy, here we go again. We all go to the Psalms for prophecy, right? Yet in Psalm 72:10-11, we read, "May the kings of Tarshish and the distant shores bring tribute to him. May the king of Sheba and Seba bring gifts. May all the kings bow down to him and all the nations serve him. The Magi who visited Jesus brought him gifts and bowed down to worship." And it's in Matthew 2:11 we read the fulfillment. "On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary. And they bowed down and worshiped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh." These kings who came from wherever it is they came from, it took however long it took, when they got there, what did they do? They opened up their chests
and presented treasure. It's all they knew to do. Jesus wanted them. God wanted them. The Holy Spirit wanted them to open up a different chest. To open their chest and give the treasure of their heart. Believe it. Number 8. He would be worshipped by shepherds. Prophecy in Psalm 72:9. May the desert tribes bow before him and his enemies lick the dust. I got to tell you, when I was in 9th grade and learned this verse, I went home and told everybody just to lick the dust. It didn't go over real well for me at home. The desert tribes are the shepherds. And the fulfillment we find in Luke 2 and in Luke 15:17. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in clothes, lying in a manger. And when the angels had left and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in a manger. And when they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child. They told you so, and it's true, so you can believe it. And number 9, Christ would be called to escape to Egypt. The prophecy we find in Hosea 11:1. You've always thought about turning to Hosea for the good Christmas story, haven't you? When Israel was a child, I loved him. And out of Egypt, I called my son. The fulfillment. God sends angels to awaken Joseph in the night and warn him of Herod's plan. And we find it in Matthew 2:13. And the angel of the Lord appears to Joseph in a dream. "Get up," he said. "Take the child and his mother and escape to Egypt. Stay there until I tell you, for Herod is going to search for the child to kill him." They told you. And the scriptures tell us. Believe it. It's not noon yet. I still have 6 minutes. And we're to number 10. The entire lineage of Jesus would be confirmed through scripture. Right there for you. Not a text, not a phone call. Not an email that could be deleted, but God's word that has lasted since the day it was penned. It's evidence. If I were in a courtroom, I would take these 10 and the other 290 with me and present one after the other, after the other, after the other, after the other as evidence. For where else could prophecy be given and fulfillment like this happen time after time after time? The lineage has been carefully marked. Prophecy, Jesus was from the line of Abraham. In Genesis, we find Isaac. In Genesis 17:26, Jacob. Genesis 28, Judah. Genesis 49, Jesse. And David in Isaiah 9 and Jeremiah 23. Fulfillment of the entire Christ line of genealogy that we find in the New Testament through a fulfillment in Matthew, the first chapter, and Luke, the first chapter. This is the genealogy of Jesus, the Messiah, the son of David, the son of Abraham. That's in Matthew. Praise be to the Lord, the God of Israel, because he has come to his people and redeemed them. He has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant, David, Luke 1, 68 and 69. It's right there. They wrote it for us. They gave it to us. They wanted us to have it. God wanted us to have it, and you can believe it. It's confirmed and it's right there. So there you go. And it's on this third Sunday of Advent in 2019. And I just thought a reminder might be in order that this is no accident. It was planned before the beginning of the world. And as you enter into the rest of this Christmas season, know that Christmas was planned before the beginning of the world. So what do you believe? Why do you believe it? Are your beliefs grounded in Scripture? Do you know that God told you so? For you see, God planned Christmas. They told them so. They tell us so. And if you believe, you can't help but have a merry Christmas. Believe it. Let us pray. Oh God, we thank you for your word. We thank you how you told us so, how you told them, how you remind us time and time and time and time again that the Redeemer, the Savior, the Messiah, that your Son was coming to do what? To redeem us. To save us. So that we might go from life to life. Because God just wants to do life with you. Oh God, thank you for your word. Thank you for these reminders. If there's anyone here today who doesn't know what they believe, would like to have a conversation about who Jesus is and why he came, I would love to have that conversation. Stephen would love to have that conversation. Billy would love, any of our elders, we'd love to have that conversation with someone. If you're looking for a church home, let this family be yours. We love having you here. Oh God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for a table that calls us and invites us. We thank you for these people, and we thank you for this place. And it's in Jesus' name that we gather and pray. Amen.
Our hymn of commitment this morning is number 96. We'll sing verses 1 and 3 of Good Christian Men Rejoice. If you will, please stand as we sing together.
Good Christian men rejoice with heart and soul and voice. Give ye heed to what we say. Jesus Christ is born today. Man and beast before him bow, and he is in the manger now. Christ is born today. Hey, Christ is born today. Good Christian men rejoice with heart and soul and voice. Now ye need not fear the grave. Jesus Christ was born to save. Calls you one and calls you all to gain his everlasting all. Christ was born to save. Christ was born to save.
Our God, we thank you for this gathering. We thank you for your presence and our worship. Amen.
Oh, come, all ye faithful, joyful.